Welcome to the Baltimore Science Fiction Society. This is our home. This is our cathedral to science fiction and fantasy. We love having you all out here. We hope you'll come back for all the other events that we have. We hope you'll come back for our book club, for our critique circle, for the next roundtable in August, which will be on diversity in the genre. We hope that you will tell your friends and family that you had a great time here, that you're going to have a great time. We hope you'll share our events on Facebook. We hope you'll spread the word for us. Every September, I man our booth at the Baltimore Book Festival, and too many people in Baltimore come up to me and say, I never heard of you guys. You guys are in Baltimore? I never knew about that. And my goal for this year is for that to not happen at all. So please, spread the word, come out to our events, share our events on Facebook, retweet them on Twitter, help us out. You didn't come here to see me, you came here to see these guys and gals, so let me get out of your way.
Woo-hoo! Yeah.
Hey, welcome. These are the touchiest mics you'll ever, you're a professional podcaster, some of you, so you should be able to handle it. My name is Sarah Pinsker. This is the State of Short Fiction today, and we've got a whole lot of stuff we want to talk about. We've got podcasters, we've got editors of online magazines, we have editors who also have anthologies of their work, we have an anthologist who is who had car trouble and will be joining us later, and we have, some of them are also subsets of podcaster and editor, or writer, and reader, which is important. Everyone's a reader too. So we're gonna talk a little bit, and then we'll get some questions from you guys. And I'm gonna let them introduce themselves. Bill Campbell, whose chair is over there, I'll introduce so that, and then we can remind you again when he gets here. But he's the editor of Mothership, Tales from Afrofuturism and Beyond. He's a native of Pittsburgh and an alumnus of Northwestern University, and has written Sunshine Patriots, My Booty Novel, and other novels. And actually, I didn't realize he was a podcaster. He hosts his weekly podcast, The Bill Campbell Misanthrope Show, on podomatic.com. So we'll save the applause for when he gets here, and we can go for Norm next.
Hi, is this on?
Just check, check, check. All right. Hi, I'm Norm Sherman. I'm the editor of EscapePod, a audio magazine online, and the Drabblecast, which is an audio magazine online as well, the producer and editor of that, and I'm a musician here in Baltimore, and I'm super, super excited to be here for you guys.
Hi, I'm Neil Clarke. I'm the publisher and editor of Clarkesworld magazine, normally online, occasionally in print, and also an anthology series, and I'm currently editing a book of cyborg stories.
And some of your anthologies are going to be back.
Yes.
Okay. I'm Scott H. Andrews. I'm the editor-in-chief and publisher of Beneath Ceaseless Skies, which is an online magazine of secondary world fantasy, fantasy set in other worlds. We also do ebook best of anthologies and an ebook theme anthology of steampunk. We've been a finalist for the Hugo Award, World Fantasy Awards. We also podcast about half our stories, and I'm the editor and director and audio engineer of the podcast. This month, we have a special science fantasy theme month. Next month will be our 300th story and 125th podcast episode.
I'm Jonathan Layden, co-founder and co-editor of Daily Science Fiction, along with Michelle, my partner, who's very, very bad pro. And in previous life as a writer, I was in the writers of the future anthology.
Hi, I'm Erica Satifka. I'm a writer, and I've been in Clarkesworld and Daily Science Fiction and some other places. And I'm a really big reader of short fiction. That's mostly what I read. So I'm here mostly as a reader and also as a writer.
And I'm going to say I chose Erica because she is the purest short fiction reader that I know. She is an expert short fiction reader and reads widely in the field. So I thought she'd be a good addition since we're trying to to look at all aspects. And my name is Sarah Pinsker, and I'm a BSFS member and a writer myself. So I'm going to start off with a really easy one, and we don't have to stick to my questions. If you guys go somewhere else, I'm fine to follow. But the easy one is, do you feel that short fiction is currently thriving, maintaining, dying? Like, when you hear all those woes, do you feel like things are still hanging in there?
I've already started talking. I think it's doing better than it has in the last decade. Currently, there are a lot more markets that are paying what Satifka considers a qualifying rate, which is good for the writers. I think there's a great variety of stories being represented in the year's best anthologies that represent a wide range of venues, from the print magazines to the online magazines to anthologies. And you're seeing Kickstarter projects for anthologies that were a little bit more narrow in focus that might not normally be taken by a small press or even a larger publisher. I benefited from it. The bar has come way down to entry, so people like me can get in. My background is in computer science. I have no background in English or literature or anything like that. I'm a fan who drifted into this line of work. It's become possible for people like me to get into the field without having to invest tens of thousands of dollars, and I think that's a good sign.
The opportunities to sell your fiction, your short fiction, have exponentially grown the last couple of years, and that obviously has controlled the market, and there's more and more short fiction as a result of that. More and more people are writing short fiction, and this is a fantastic thing. It's an extraordinarily fun medium to write in. There's the Drabblecast. Drabbles are stories that are 100 words, so flash fiction's taken off, daily science fiction. A lot of these markets focus on flash fiction. There's a lot of Twitter fiction, the 140 character stories. There's a lot of creativity going on in the short form medium, and that's an exciting, very exciting thing. Like Neil said, there's a lot of focus on anthologies, and it's really, I think it's definitely the last decade. This is the year, or this is the decade of short fiction, and I, for one, since it's my favorite medium, I'm extraordinarily excited about that.
One boon I see in this renaissance or rebirth, if you will, is that it has also encouraged and fostered niche markets. BCS is only secondary world fantasy. We don't do science fiction. And there was a while where all the top zines were generalist zines that do science fiction and fantasy, because those were making better money, and the more niche magazines were not making money and were not doing well. But I knew there were still readers out there who wanted to read that stuff. They wanted to get it. And there were writers who were writing it, in many cases the same writers who were writing the science fiction. So the fact that the digital opportunities existed were, for me, a major point of accessibility in being able to start a magazine that was going to have a niche. And these readers and writers were there, as I had expected and hoped, which was great. But being able to do it digitally and not have to invest not have to have my basement full of remainder back issues, basically, was key. And I think you're seeing more niche magazines crop up, partly because of that, like Galaxy's Edge doing harder science fiction. So I think that's a great part of this boom as well, is you're seeing not only just lots of magazines, but lots of interesting different things as well.
It seems to me that there's some really very strong writing out there, and that it's easy to find. And it's possible that part of the reason why we're seeing more strong writing is because there are more markets, and because the turnaround is so much faster for the writers. Remember 10 or 15 years ago, when you sent a story out, they could get caught for a year and a half. And by the time that story actually found its right home and got published, it could be 5 years later. And the volume of stories, great stories that could get out there, was just that much less.
I would put it on, so I think it's definitely expanding. The internet has, completely changed the landscape. Before, there was no... I think the first magazine I ever found was Strange Horizons, and it was online, and I think that it was the only one for like 5 or 6 years until Clarkesworld and some other magazines came around. And ever since then, I think everything's just expanded. Like with, you know, you have magazines that are just blogs that have fiction in them. Then you have like audio-only zines like EscapePod, and you have other things that, you know, mix like, you know, images with words. And I think that, you know, the amount of distribution channels we have has caused, you know, short fiction to explode over the past like decade or so.
One other point I just remembered. I think the other thing that's changed, the internet has allowed the short fiction market to become international. So we're not only getting a broader distribution, but we're also receiving more stories from foreign writers. It used to be very expensive for them to submit to the paper submissions. And now we're seeing some very amazing international writers showing up in our pages now.
That was actually one of the next things I wanted to ask you, so we can seg into that. Have the rest of you found that you've opened up more? It's international writers and also international audiences.
Definitely the audiences as well. BCS has a story this year that's a finalist for the Aurealis Award in Australia. We had another one 5 years ago that won the Aurealis Award. So there's definitely, I get a very solid amount of submissions from Australian writers, and there's definitely some readership down there and some award recognition for that, so absolutely. And I think anywhere in the world that English is read and spoken and where they have an IP address is accessible to the online fiction. I think that's great, which includes the audio fiction as well. That can be accessed and downloaded and listened to as well.
I will say that in terms of, we don't do such extensive editing that from the non-English speaking world, a lot of the work comes in, has some great ideas, but still needs some work in terms of the language and the editing, and that's not something we do at science fiction, but it is out there.
And you also do, Neil, just to follow this one more step, you also do some works in translation, so you have people submitting works in translation.
Yeah, we've received a few submissions in translation from Ken Liu. Has been great to work with over the last year. He knows some amazingly talented authors that are published in China, and he's been working to bring them over, and I think he's done a translation of a novel recently. So he's somebody who's been very aggressive out there. There's also the World SF group that was trying to call attention. They have a award that goes to the best translated story in the year. We're trying to encourage more works in translation. They're very difficult to come by because the translator needs to be as talented or more talented than the original author. We've had some stories coming from authors who've translated their own work, and yet some of them have needed more work to get them cleaned up. And others have been fine, like amazing, that didn't realize that their English would be that strong. I can tell you one other number. I know from our statistics that about 30% of our audience is from outside the United States. Now, the bulk of that would probably be UK, Australia, Canada, but there's still a large representation, and I was surprised that one of our podcasts was heavily downloaded from Iran. I don't know if there was something we said in that, very revealing looking at some of those statistics sometimes.
Yeah, you know, like you mentioned, audio, it's another avenue that people are reselling their reprints and able to explore different profit margins and whatnot for their fiction. But it's interesting because we've had a lot in EscapePod and Drabblecast of international authors coming in, and it's always a challenge to do that story production accurately with the right pronunciation, with the right just ethos, you know, the whole vibe behind the culture. Finding the right narrator has become very difficult sometimes for us, but it's extremely important because when you read the story in print and it really moves you and you know you need to do it in audio, sometimes it'll take months to track down the right person to read that story and the right way to produce that story. But you know, like you mentioned, this is a global market here, and it's fantastic to publish these authors and do their stories in audio as well.
Anyone else? Okay, how about, since we're talking about international, how has the nature of online publications also led to a more diverse authorship in other ways and a more diverse readership? I know that you, and I don't mean to keep putting you on the spot, but I know you look at a lot of statistics, certainly gender, and then part of it is just where people are submitting from, I guess.
So you're talking diversity by gender and by, I don't track ethnicity, but from what I understand, we're doing pretty well.
By story topic too, like are you seeing a diversity of topics? That you...
Not as much as I'd like, but I think every editor feels that way because so much of the stuff that comes in is very derivative or
zombies.
10% of every slush pile is a zombie, and after a while you just it's easy to reject them, but we track a lot of statistics through our submissions, so all our submissions come in electronically. I maintain a database that I share with a couple of people who use the same software as I do. And so I know that 30% of the submissions that come in are from women. 30% of the submissions that come in, I think, are international. Again, non-US is international. The patterns of reading, listening, and submitting seem to follow that breakdown. We don't know much about our readership. We get small samples. We get from Facebook some data, from surveys others. But we have over 30,000 people reading the online version, and we don't know who they are, aside from their IP address, which can track them back to country. I think that we've been, last year I think we published 55 or 60% women. Which is higher than historical averages, but I think it's a good sign for the health of the field.
Anyone else? You can feel free to answer as a reader also, whether you're seeing a reader.
I will say that I read both some of the big three. I read FSF and Asimov, and I also read a large selection of the online ones. And I'll say that the online ones I feel have a much greater diversity, more women, more non-USers. And also, frankly, I feel that the quality of fiction tends to be a little bit better. Not that I'm complaining about the big three, but I think that online just allows you to experiment so much more with what you're doing. You can have really long stories. You can, like, there's a online magazine called Giganotosaurus that publishes only stories over, I think, 6,000 words. And then there's DSF, where there's other flash fiction places that publish really, really short stories, and I don't think you see that kind of diversity of style and such in the big three or in anthologies, unless it's specifically a flash fiction anthology or specifically a long story anthology. You tended to get mostly 4,000 word stories, largely people from the U.S., and I feel like, the internet just made it so much more of an international community with short fiction that it's a real, important thing for SF in general that this has started to happen.
Susan Connolly has an article coming out and some research in Strange Horizons, I think, next month, specifically about women in science fiction. And so she made us look through our files a little bit. And we did publish a slightly more than 50% fiction by women last year. But still, the submission rate is probably about 30% women. And so things are changing, and they're coming along. But it's hard to know exactly how well and how sustainable those gains are. When we had the reading for the Daily Science Fiction Anthology last month here, 9 authors came, and actually we were surprised to see what a broad diversity of writers there were. But again, it's awfully hard to know out there how the numbers are changing. At least we don't really track it.
To me, I think part of it may be that online fiction, with all of its various facets, has reached this sort of stage of critical mass where authors have seen what Neil was publishing 8 years ago, what I was publishing 4 years ago. So authors know that there are places for stories like this. Maybe international, a tiny bit of it may be the postage. I can email this to Neil instead of having to go get international reply coupons or whatever. But I think it's more that authors not only in the US and Europe, but around the world, are seeing that there are homes for these things. They can submit them. They can be part of an international scene as the authorship and readership of this magazine. And I love seeing qualitatively, when I log onto social media, our new issues come out at midnight every fortnight, Eastern US time. And sometimes when I get up in the morning over breakfast and check at 7 in the morning, a story's already got several comments. So that means those people are in Europe or ahead of us time-wise. And then, you know, at midnight there'll be more comments. That's for people in the Pacific area. And I think that's great that this fiction, these ideas, this art form is percolating overnight while I'm asleep and the other side of the planet is in the sunshine. I think that's amazing.
Yeah, EscapePod also participated in the study you're talking about with Susan, and one thing I learned from that, 30% was accurate with us as well, that of female women submitters, but there was a higher percentage of women in the slush pile that were accepted on a regular basis. It was somewhere around 60-70%, so factoid for you ladies out there. It was an encouraging thing to know, and it's neat when these studies come out because it leverages the editors to look into this kind of data and to think about these things, because we tend to be in our own worlds and to be thinking strategically for as far as markets and businesses, and sometimes, you know, we let these things slide, and it was an educational experience for me to go through our data and to look at that kind of stuff. So,
do you think there's room strategically to make those choices early? Do you make them before you read the stories or after you read the stories? And I guess part of that question is, when you see a table of contents and, you know, and there's 13 men and one woman, or you know, 12 names you can identify as male and a couple that are initials and you don't know anything, and then also other facets of diversity, just in trying to make science fiction more diverse, you still have to serve the story first.
Yeah. Well, that's absolutely true. You know, it's sometimes tempting. I think Neil was talking over dinner how you don't read cover letters. I try not to. One of the challenges with looking through that data was a lot of authors use pen names that are different genders, and so when we're trying to really find out what your gender is, getting through that. You know, Alice Sheldon is one of my favorite writers ever, and it's just an amazing thing that she did. But for somebody who's trying to garner this kind of interest and also look at these numbers, it's just difficult sometimes when using pen names. But I try to, the story should stand on its own regardless of gender, but there clearly has been in the past a misrepresentation. So I think anybody would be lying to themselves if they weren't, you know, honest with the fact that there has been misrepresentation, but we all have our editorial and artistic integrity to consider, and the story has to stand on its own as well.
One of the things that I like you said, I don't read the cover letter. I quite often ignore the author's name in the process as well. And I discovered that most of the stories I liked were by women. And I actually had one of the opposite concerns was, whoa, wait, we don't have that many men. So I, when we first started, we would solicit half the stories we published. And we deliberately made sure to seek out balance. We don't need to do that anymore. I can see 10% either way. That's okay. But I watch statistics, and it just seems to balance itself out. You know, I've never had to actually go and say, you know, I better start soliciting stories for men because we don't have enough. It just auto corrects for us.
Norm is mentioning the story coming first, and that touches on a thing that I think about when I think about diversity as well, is that I also want the story characters and the story situations to reflect a diversity in addition to the authorship. I want both. And I don't care if an author from a non-traditionally common background is writing a story that has characters that aren't. I want the diversity in the pools of both. And to me, that's very powerful because it shows readers that a story about characters who may be from a non-traditionally represented background, that story can be just as powerful a comment on the genre, just as successful as a genre story, also just as powerful a comment on what it means to be human, which I think is why all humans read. It can work just as well as any other story out there. And I think it also shows authors that authors from any background can do just as well, can write just as great, and can be end up in our magazines just as well as any other author. And that to me is very powerful, because by showing the readership and the authorship that, it encourages them to read more, and also encourages those authors to write whatever story moves them and then send it in and see what happens.
Yeah, I think that another thing is, when you're a writer submitting these slush piles, when you see people in the magazine who are like you, who are women, who maybe not straight, who are disabled, things like that, it makes you feel comfortable to submit there. A lot of times, if you would see like a magazine that maybe only published like Silverberg and all these other really big names and never published any new writers, never published any women, I can see that people would get scared away from the slush pile. And I think that, as a woman, submitting to Clarkesworld, not any sort of feeling like, oh, they're not going to take me because I'm not big enough, or I'm not, the right kind of writer. I think that's really important too, the fact that when you look at a table of contents and see names that are maybe similar to yours, or see stories that are like yours, it really, has like a snowball effect on diversity.
I think that works with characters too. An author who I've published, who happens to be active in the LGBT community, said once about BCS, publishes stories about people like me without any fuss. And I do think there is a link between readers and a character they can empathize with, they can understand. And that's exactly what I'm going for, is stories about people like all you readers, without any fuss, so you can enjoy them and experience them for what they are.
We're talking about serious stuff, so I'm gonna break into, who are some of the new voices people should be reading, just for a second to break things up a little bit.
Do you want me to pronounce it?
You don't have to do all of them now, we can talk about it again later.
Benjamin Sridwengau, who is from Singapore, who I asked last summer how to pronounce her name. So that's how I know. She is a candidate for the Campbell Award this year, but she's had one story in BCS and another one coming next week, and one or two with you?
Two with us, one next month.
And she's been in, has she been in Strange Horizons? She's been in many places, and in my opinion, she's quite worthy of Campbell consideration. I think she's a great writer.
Her first year, too. I think everything was just in last year.
An older name that I think more people should be reading but may not is Yoon-Ha Lee, who's been selling for over 10 years. And I've had several by her, and I know Neil has. She was in FNSF many times, about 10, 12, 8 years ago. And I think she's great as well. She had a collection out last year with Prime Books, that has many of her great stories reprinted in that, so I highly recommend her.
One of the strong things about both of those also is they can write science fiction and fantasy, and very well, hop from one genre to another. Someone who sort of popped up on my radar more recently was Seth Dickinson, who's in our current issue. He's the first author to sell two stories within 1 month to us, so we actually had to sit on one for a while. So he's definitely another on my list.
I have one by Seth this month out right now. And another one coming in May. I apparently don't feel the compulsion to sit on them, but he's definitely up there, yes.
I can think of a lot of names, but the two that I think I'm most excited about right now are Nikki Drayton, who just has a lot of great ideas in her stories, and Connor Powers, which has fallen along.
I was also going to mention Seth Dickinson. I really liked his story in Strange Horizons, also his story in Clarkesworld. Another one who's popped up with a number of really great stories is Bonnie Jo Stufflebeam. She's been in Inner Zone recently, also in Clarkesworld, I think also in DSF, and her stuff is just really, really great. And definitely recommended. And her name is awesome.
You got any, Norm?
Sure, yeah.
I'll throw in a second for Nikki Drayden, as she was the managing editor for Drabblecast for 3 years. But also Alex Schwartzman has been somebody that I've been really keeping tabs on. We've run him a couple times on EscapePod and Drabblecast, and he's a fantastic writer.
And
editor, yes.
Hold on 1 second. All right. It seems Bill Campbell is in the house. You were already not introduced.
Oh, really?
And I can do it again if you want.
No. Just tell me who I am.
All right. You've been introduced as an anthologist and podcaster.
Okay.
And Mothership has been introduced, and a writer. All right, and I can put you on the spot for 1 second. We're just talking about new writers that people are excited about, or new voices people should be reading. If you have an answer, you can answer. Otherwise, you can wait.
Catch your breath. Oh, wait. Sorry. My card didn't work.
He called and said his car had broken down and he wasn't going to make it, which I was very disappointed in. And then he wrote back that he was going to make it after all. He was borrowing a car, so that is dedication. Let him catch his breath for a second, and we can talk about podcasting for a few minutes. Well, actually, you are a podcaster too, so never mind. Let him catch his breath.
Don't worry about it.
Yeah. All right, cool. everyone on this side of the room, sorry guys, I'm going to turn this way for a second, is a podcaster of some sort. And so part of my question is, what makes a story work for a podcast? Some of you are reading, you're reading for podcast first. But the rest of you, do you keep that in mind as you're looking at stories that this would make a good audio story?
No.
To me, it's the story itself, pure and simple. And I think it's because I podcast about half of the story, so my initial decision is not, am I going to podcast this? My initial decision is this an awesome story? Do I must have it? And then after that, I sit and select which half. And sometimes it's a length issue because of the secondary world fantasy. I think our average story length is probably about 7,000 or 8,000 words. And that's on the longer end of what I can comfortably podcast given time and resources. So length is a minor factor. I think the thing I look for in any story more than anything is voice. I want a voice that's saying something interesting in an interesting way, and that's really reaching out to me and moving me. And I think that in most cases, a story that has a voice that's doing that is going to end up being interesting if that voice of the story is portrayed out loud as audio. I don't think that's always the case. Sometimes language or lexicon things don't quite come out in the audio medium. But I do think more often than not, I would be curious to go back at our 120 podcast episodes and wonder how many of them are first person and how many are third. Because I do think first person naturally lends itself, because that is a narrator already telling you the story. It might be 60-40. We still do plenty of third person, and those do seem to work well. Although I've had some, there was one story that had epigraphs in it before each scene, and I thought about that and I said, I'm not sure that would come over well. And Podcast ended up doing a podcast version of that story as a reprint later, and it came out great, and the fans loved it. So perhaps I was not correct in my initial evaluation. So that kind of struck me, and I have kept that in mind, trying to be even more open about what feeling no restrictions about what to do in audio.
That was a great story. That's a great example of that too. We're different from you guys in the sense that we do look for audio first, and stories that have time shifts and things like that, and the narrator switching places, whatnot, stand a less chance unless we feel like we could creatively pull it off with the producer. That's a big consideration. We podcast 100% of our stories in both markets. I think that it really does come into play on how creative you can be. And then you've got this spectrum of a straight read to audio drama, which is big. There's a resurgence of the old-time radio drama right now, and a lot of markets will do a full-out audio production with music and with multiple voice actors and things like that, and really transform a story that's already fantastic and move it to this other, just different level of engagement. but we're catering towards a market that has more leisure time on the go, on the treadmill, taking their dogs for walks, in the car, things like that. That's the demographic we're looking for, and so that's what we target our content a lot of times for. And what one of our goals is to make it really engaging in audio, so finding the perfect narrator and finding that that line to where audio drama and a straight read meet a lot of times without going overboard. The last thing you want to do is ruin a story with a cheesy sound effect or music where a violin really takes over the attention of the listener, and instead of the story needs to come out and pop out in high resolution against everything else. So audio production, audio engineering is such a huge factor for the podcast market, because you really have to know about EQ and about the technical specifics of working things in audio. And then we put it in print as well in both markets, but we don't do ebooks, we don't do all of these kind of things, because it's just a different type of demographic that we're trying to market out to.
Do you have anything about that?
My podcast was just like rants and funk, so. I do actually work. I record audiobooks for the blind for the Library of Congress. So if I were to do it, I mean, I know the difference between the written word that's supposed to be read and which is supposed to be heard. And I don't think that there's any way that you could get around not taking your stories and considering like how hard it is to narrate or what kind of flow that you would have with that, like that would have to affect it. But that's
sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, no, we podcast all five of the stories that we publish each month. And I do take it into consideration because we do publish all of them, so we need to make sure they'll work. There have been a few stories that were rejected because we couldn't make them work in audio. They had parallel thoughts going on, and it worked fine on paper. It was actually also a problem in some of the other formats. We pay attention to whether or not it'll work online, in ebook, or whatever. I have a narrator, so I don't actually do the reading of any of them. And I generally hear in my head, "Kate will kill you." or "Kate will cry." And usually cry means we can still run it.
Do any of you have a podcast other than your own that you want to recommend because you enjoy listening to it? I'll just throw that out there.
I'll mention one, Synthetic Voices, by a podcaster named Jimmy Rogers out of the DC area. He listens to all sorts of podcasts and short fiction from the previous month. And then he does sort of an aggregate or review, a single episode of his podcast, where he gives you what his picks were out of all the stuff he listened to. You know, several top picks and several honorable mentions and so on. So I think that is a great resource if you don't have time to listen to, well, you should listen to all three of ours, right? Yours, absolutely. But as an aggregator of different things that are going on from all the markets that he surveys, so for a one-stop, dipping your toe into the what's available that previous month, Synthetic Voices, and you can find him online.
www.scienceismagic.com.
www.scienceismagic.com, just to repeat that.
Anyone else have a podcast that you want to recommend? There's one done by novelist Tina Connolly called Toasted Cake. She does mostly Flash, and it's, you know, cute Flash stories if you only have maybe 10, 15 minutes to listen to a story.
Cool. All right. Anyone else? No. All right.
Cool. I'll shift gears again since we have our anthologist in the house. And I'm going to ask, if someone were going to start a short fiction magazine today, or a podcast, or an anthology, you can answer it from your wheelhouse. What advice would you give them to go about it, Kickstarter, etc.?
The answer isn't don't.
But the first question is why?
Why?
And acknowledging that you're not going to make a lot of money at this. Most of them don't, and if that's why you're getting in for the wrong reasons. Yeah, it's not easy. It's a lot of work. I suggest volunteering as a slush reader at some place before you decide to jump in and edit your own. The one thing that sort of bothers me about the current magazine market, a lot of them looking to Kickstarter as a business model. That's fine for starting your funding, but to continually be going back to the well, I think, is a dangerous precedent. Eventually, Kickstarter fatigue kicks in, and you are out of business. Develop multiple revenue streams. That's what I tell everybody.
I'm actually curious, Neil, what you think about the Strange Horizons model, which is basically an annual fundraiser-driven model.
I think they also have a patron. I'm not sure. But they, you know, even when they miss gold, they still keep going. So I think that that's one way of doing things. I think it's a dangerous way, but they're also nonprofit. So there's some, you know, advantages there. Our business model is sell subscriptions, sell ebooks, sell print books, sell whatever we can, and advertising, and we're on Patreon, and we take donations, and basically it's all of those things put together keep us stable and allow us to continue doing what we do and grow, which I think that you really have to have a plan in mind when you start a magazine of how you intend to get to point B and C and D. And we've been very lucky. I think that's a major factor in all of these things is there's luck. There's the skill and luck is a combination.
I'll second the luck with ebooks coming along 2 years after I started the magazine, absolutely. The nonprofit, BCS is a nonprofit like Strange Horizons, 501c3 certified by the IRS. And I do think that helps in some ways as far as the donations, they're tax deductible. We get donations not only through our website, but also the people donate through Network for Good, which is a charity that does donations for, accepts donations on behalf of other charities. So I think that helps. And we get a lot of donations in December when people are looking to deduct things off their taxes, right? So that does help. But of course, ebooks are a huge help as well, and definitely all part of what goes on there. Another interesting thing that happened around the time CIFO announced the raise of the pay rate that will take effect this summer, announced it in December, I believe. We got a rash of donations after they made the announcement from people who were concerned that BCS as a donation-based magazine might need more resources to help meet this new high rate, which we do, of course. The rate needs to be, we will meet the rate and we want to. And I was very heartened by that response, unsolicited response from people in the field who were concerned about this. So at the risk of perhaps sounding mercantile, if you like a magazine, perhaps purchase it on ebook or give a small donation, because I guarantee you they will appreciate it and they will use that money to go out and buy a great story and give it to you next month.
Thanks. I guess I'm the new kid on the block, so because we're not even a year old and our first thing came out in October, so I totally did it ass backwards. Didn't really think I was going to really start a company. It was just sort of like Mothership was just an idea that I had, and which was, you know, concentrating on people of colors, science fiction stories, people of color. So it's like something, an anthology. I was like, wow, you know, somebody ought to do that. And then one day I was like, oh shit, it's gonna be me. So I got a friend of mine who's an editor and who knew a lot more about science fiction than I did. And I was like, hey, you wanna do it? And he said, fine. And then we just asked people. And then we started getting names that were way above our weight class, and then we were like, oh wow, this is really serious. So it's been kind of like a backward, you know, modeling the whole thing, and now we're just publishing other books. It just kind of I guess the whole thing was I just had like this idea and this vision, and then just did it. And then just because of the way the technology is, you know, with the internet and the ebooks and, you know, print on demand and all these other things, that you can just sort of do it, you know? So that's kind of the way that I look at it. It's like, but you know, it's not easy, and you're not going to make money. And I mean, to pull Mothership off, I mean, that was a year of like a lot of work. And then we did the Indiegogo thing, and that was a month of my sitting at a computer begging everybody I knew, because you know, we weren't anybody. Like, nobody knew who we were. We couldn't cash in, like, you know, say, hey, you know, we've been around for 10 years, support this. So it was like, no, who are you? You know, so we just, yeah, I mean, you would have to love it in order to do it, I think.
Something I think that Neil really touched on, the most important thing being the why instead of the how. Finding a niche, finding something that you do special, and really concentrating on your brand, because otherwise you're, the only other option to really proliferate and to do well is to do something better than somebody who's already been at it for a while, and that's a lot tougher. I think everybody at this table has come to the place that they're at through trial and error a lot of times, through trying their best to do strategic thinking and to do marketing that kind of way. But you learn as you go, and there's no one set model. That's the really important thing to know, is that there is no, Kickstarter would work great for some people for webcomics and other people, it's not gonna work for others. And like you said, it's definitely not a reliable ongoing fundraising model for a lot of people, but there really is no rules on the internet. So I think the important thing is having an identity, having something that you sell and that you're passionate about, you know, people of color, something that really just pops out and that you feel like you have to do, you know, and then kind of letting the funding sources and whatnot, if you're doing something really well, the funding, if you build it, they will come, kind of works a little bit to some degree, at least in my experience. The most important thing is to crank good content out, like a short order chef, you know, just keep it coming, be reliable, be on schedule, and to be passionate about what you do. And that comes through to your listenership, and you might go with a donor-based model, you might sell content, you might have different levels of premium subscribers and whatnot. I mean, the truth kind of shows itself after you start with what you want to do and what you think will make an impact on the overall market. So.
I love all three of you, what you've said. To me, the why, I'm a short story writer too, to me the why is like a character's motivation. Why are you driven to do what you do? You have an idea, and I had the same moment. Who's gonna do this? Well, shit, it has to be me. And that's the passion. That's the passion for that idea. So maybe that's the great answer here if you want to start a zine or an anthology. Do you have a great character motivation? Do you have a great interest and passion in doing this? And then are you willing to say, well, shit, it has to be me, and follow through with that and crank out that short order cooked content and provide it?
Okay. So, do you think crowdfunding has leveled the playing field at all in terms of, Ellen Detlow was here at the book festival 2 years ago, and she said that she was having trouble getting publishers to buy anthologies, and she only had one or two coming that year, and she said they're just like not into anthologies right now. But you look at Kickstarter, and you look at what's going on, and there's Mothership and Long Hit, and we see a different frontier. There are all these fantastic, and it might be the niche marketing that you were talking about. Like, there are people who want to read these books, but is it crowdfunding that's helping get those out there, or is it just people really want to see them published?
Or I guess that's me, huh?
Both.
hey, again. Well, the interesting thing was, because, you know, because of tax time, I had to go through all of that Indiegogo stuff, which it was really cool when I got the 650 donors, and you know, and then doing taxes, I was like, oh my goodness. But what I discovered was it was a lot of writers supported it. So in a way, it's interesting because it was sort of like these were the people who wanted to see it and they supported it. But you know, as far as like a new publisher goes, you know, you just have a lot of other obstacles. So in a way, it levels the playing field, as in you can get it done. But as far as getting it out and having people see it or write about it or whatever, especially if you're new, then you have that whole issue. So there are tons of people in this community, especially with the writers, who know Mothership, but I mean, the general public doesn't, you know.
I think that what happens with Kickstarters, you just reduce your risk. So you're allowed to take bigger chances. I went with Kickstarter for my anthology because it was a very personal project. For those who don't know, I had a heart attack, which ended with me being becoming a cyborg with a pacemaker, or a defibrillator, excuse me. And so I was editing, as a cyborg, editing a cyborg anthology. So I thought, well, this will be fun, and I can control it all myself then, because it is such a personal project. So I'm not going to lose money publishing this anthology. I know that there's, you know, about 500 people who are definitely going to get it, and then it can go into distribution a little bit further, and we'll see whether or not it succeeds on its own. It could be a wild success, it could be a stunning failure, but in the end, the people who were interested in seeing it happen, help make it happen, will be happy that they get what they wanted, and in my mind, that keeps it from being a complete failure.
I think it has perhaps changed the bar in some of these ways. Some of these models existed in the rock and roll music scene earlier, like taking contributions before a project was done and then giving people the CD later after the contributions had paid for the recording costs. So I think it gives the security or lowers the risk beforehand. And I think it's sort of akin to how the digital and online publishing have reduced the infrastructure or investment or startup cost. So I think it has made it more accessible for people who have a strong motivation or a great idea to give them the vehicle to get that out there. And whether that means that the New York City publishers that Ms. Datlow was talking about are, you know, less interested in taking risks or investing a lot in a big anthology, I'm not sure. But I do love the fact, I do love all the different niches and voices you can see pop up because that bar is more accessible than it used to be.
Do you think there are still big anthologies and big anthologists? Like, you used to, you know, everyone read Dangerous Visions. Are there still anthologies that everyone has read? I don't know if there's an answer to that, but are there people who are big anthologists right now?
JJ.
Yeah,
the Vandermeer's JJA. There's different play. I mean, so Charlene may be known with one side of the field and not the other. There's a number of people who don't know she's done it, which is kind of, I spent 7 years as a bookseller, so it was very interesting watching some of these things. I don't know that there's a rock star editor at the moment, though.
Probably John Joseph Adams is the closest you get, or...
I think that the whole long tail effect has caused a kind of splintering. I don't think we're not all reading the same thing anymore. I mean, not that we ever all were reading the exact same thing, but I think that, you know, it's more possible now that, you know, if you are interested in diverse science fiction and you're reading Mothership, you're reading We Different See a Different Frontier, you're supporting those Kickstarters. If you want more, I guess, traditional science fiction, you're reading different kinds of anthologies. If you only care about fantasy, you're reading a fantasy anthology. I think it's more splintered now than it was in the past, and that's both good because we get more of what we want, but it also means, I guess, less readers in general for each anthology, because there are some people, like I didn't even know Charlene Harris did anthologies, so I'm one of the ones who had no idea because I don't read much, you know, urban fantasy. So again, I think long tail effect has led to a large splintering of you know, the genre, which, you know, good and bad.
And a counterpoint to that may be, there were 2 years best fantasy series that I used to read, and they both were shut down by their publishers. One was Hartwell and Kramer from Tor, and the other was the one that Gavin and Kelly and it may be that the new upstart of indie anthologies in more niche subjects has replaced that.
Erica mentioned the fracturing, and last year for the Hugo, I think it was, there were only 3 short story nominees, which is probably presumably because everyone was reading and liking different things, so there were just all the books were spread across a wider. Is the field fracturing is part of the question? Is it a bad thing if it is? Is the other side of it?
I would say I don't think it's fracturing. I think the availability of all this fiction in such an easily accessible format. When I was starting to publish stories was maybe 6-7 years ago, and most of mine were in paper print places, and trying to share with someone an old story in print was just a tremendous pain in the ass. You had to order back issues or find them, right? So nowadays, with so much stuff online, and not just original but also reprints, if a story comes up for an award, it's almost always available online. Maybe it was original online. If it's not, it often gets reprinted right before the award ballots deadline is. So I think the mathematical quirk that happened in that Hugo ballot last year was just a result of the fiction being so much more accessible, and people could get out and read it, and had so many more favorite stories. And you got the vote split over a bunch of different stories because people could read them and find them all.
Evidently, the Hugo rules have not been very good, and they've been fighting over them for a long time. And it was actually just been blind luck, I think, that it didn't happen sooner.
Well, I can't complain too much about last year. We had two of the three. But yeah, I think that if that happens again this year, there'll probably be some movement to try and rewrite that 5% rule into something that makes a little more sense. I think as more stories are being published, the votes are spreading a bit more. And as the demographics of who's voting for the Hugos are changing too, I think. So that's impacting things. Personally, I think that kind of pool that ended up with only three making that 5%, that was actually pretty good. That meant there were a lot of good stories, or a lot of stories that people felt were good that particular year. So, you know, hopefully that trend continues without tripping up the award.
I was hoping the answer was it's a good thing. So.
I think it is a good thing. At the same time, and I don't want to get thrown out of here for saying this, but I don't think the Hugo should be taken so seriously as a lot of times that they are. It's a great thing for the genre, but at the same time, it's in no way, there's a lot of fantastic fiction that's not represented at all and has nothing to do with any of that that's circulated on there. And sometimes we get in our own little bubbles and really focus on some of these things whenever there's just this amazing world of things spinning around it that just is completely carefree about all that bureaucracy and about the arguments and about this and that. It's important to remember that there's a lot of people that are represented in that conversation.
Okay. And you were mentioning that there's more availability. Some of the stories it's easier to get to. We see articles go viral on Facebook and Twitter all the time. So what does it take? This is a constructive question. What does it take to get a story to go viral? I think the closest I've seen is the Rachel Swirsky story from last year, that if you were a dinosaur, my love. That's the only story I've seen that much passing.
Okay. The best way to get a story to go viral is not to try at all. They're lightning strikes. They happen on their own. We've had a couple. Peter Watts, The Things, is probably the most read story we've ever published. It continually gets visits on our site and downloads on the podcast. Anytime the movie The Thing comes up, someone inevitably goes, "You really have to read this story." And then we get buried, particularly if this happens on Reddit or someplace like that. We saw retweets by Will Wheaton and other people at that level. We could never have predicted that. We could never have even tried to accomplish that. You know, we'd all love them. If you're an online magazine, one of those stories going viral is amazing. If it doesn't crash your site, you see a huge spike in your readership for that month. But some of them stay, because that's the first time they've heard about you. And that's one of the problems we still have as a field, that there's still a lot of people who don't know about the short fiction markets. They think that the only ones that exist are in print or no longer in print because they can't see them over the edge of the Barnes & Noble display.
So we publish about 200 authors a year, and there are a few authors out there, and they're not necessarily the people you think of or necessarily say the best authors, but they just have thousands of followers through Reddit or wherever it is, and you get these spikes, and it is really amazing, and it's hard to follow, but it almost has nothing to do with the fiction. It's the following, the cult personality that these people have.
One thing I think is that I've seen, you know, other stories go viral, and I think humor has a lot to do with it. I think, again, you can't predict what's going to be a breakout story, what's going to be a frequently downloaded story, but I see short is good, you know, humor is good. Another one that went viral fairly recently was Wiki History. I think his name was Desmond Wurzel wrote it, and yeah, that was a humor story, and it was very good. I've even seen some dead science fiction stories passed around by people who aren't writers, just because they were cute and funny, and, you know, were stories you could read basically in 5 minutes. I think that, you know, a novelette probably won't go viral quite as easily. And the Sulsky story was a very short story.
How did the baking version of Spar do compared to the regular version?
Spar was probably our second most read story. It went viral as well. The bacon version, which I also call the antidote, is not nearly as well, but it's only been around for a year. So I think we'll see in a few years.
And do you see stories ever pick up steam later? Like you said, the things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, then that'll happen.
Have you seen that happen, Jonathan? Or
No, not with.
I see that happen often with the podcast episode downloads. Many of the podcasts seem to have a very, very long tail. And sometimes the ones that will show up in my tally, my top 100 tally, will be episodes from 2 or 3 or 5 years ago. And I haven't correlated that with if it's author name or something like that. But I do see a very long tail on those. It may be new people coming to the podcast, but it's and finding the older episodes, but it seems to be sort of a scattering of very long tails on them. As far as any virus hitting viral, the best-selling single-issue ebook ever of BCS is by an author whose military SF Kindle novel hit the roof about a year later. So I recommend that strategy to anyone who's planning on that.
No, I mean, I've had something with bacterial.
I'm going to ask like one or two more questions and then see if the audience has some questions, and then I've got more if they don't.
I don't know how many of you it applies to, but it's a question about novellas and novelettes, which a lot of people say are the genre's greatest strength, but they aren't necessarily the thing that play best in online fiction. Some can argue, but I'm curious. The market for those stories has contracted a bit, and I'm curious, what do you think the future of the novella and the novelette will be?
Or has it?
Or has it? I'm here to be arguing with you.
Because one of the things I enjoy is that there's no page count. If I want to put a 13,000 word story on one web page, you know, your little scroll bar is going to get tiny there. But that's really about it. And I have heard that, you know, some readers prefer shorter lengths online. But I think the overriding factor is it a great story? If it's going to keep them hooked for 13,000 words, I think they're still going to read it. And that, of course, is my primary focus. And qualitatively, at least, after 250 stories, that has really been borne out. The really good long stories people are happy to read through. I do think there's a bit of a sweet spot, and in terms at least of what I will do at BCS in packaging things, is 13 or 14,000 is about the max I'll put on a single web page for a single story. If it's longer than that, I'll split it in half. Two-parters is the largest I will do. And there does seem to me to be a bit more of an energy barrier for a two-parter. You know, I do make them wait till the next issue until they get the second part. And for me as a reader, partly again because it's secondary world fantasy, I do think that sometimes results in a longer word count as authors spend a little more time building the world. And I enjoy that. So for me, the sweet spot, I think, comes in at about 8,000 words. give or take, and that's probably our average length. But I have noticed no problem from readers on longer things that were cool enough to keep the reader interested for that long.
We publish a few novelettes each year. We've published one novella that we serialized. And one of the things we discovered from that little experiment was that readers of short fiction are very instant gratification and were not happy about having to wait. So they, well, or they waited and read all three at once. And so as an experiment, it pretty much told us all we needed to know. If we run a novella, we're going to run the whole thing. But we don't because of budget. That's really what it comes down to. As we grow, hopefully we can do some, but at this point, not yet.
Yeah, I think you factor into the fact that a lot of markets have a niche like daily science fiction and toasted cake, where shorter fiction is par, and then in my experience, it has become harder to sell novels and novelettes and novellas because of the proliferation of short fiction markets out there. A lot of us have a podcast affixed to our website if we're not a podcast audio magazine, and just the logistics of and the cost, like Neil just said, of producing a novella in audio is exponential compared to something that's flash or shorter fiction, and it just really comes down to numbers a lot of times. As a narrator and storyteller myself, it is extraordinarily time-consuming to read a novella or a 10,000, 15,000 word story compared to a couple thousand words. It's a task that is gargantuan. And so it's really got to be a good story, and then the question comes down to, is it going to be serialized? Is your audience prepared or ready for that? Obviously, serialization of novels is a big thing right now. Authors are doing that all over the place, but when you're talking about that weird range between the, you know, the novella kind of area, it becomes that question, do you really want to put this in one part, or do you want to put this in two or three parts? Because instant gratification is something that we're all familiar with, I think, in that area.
I don't really... It doesn't really apply to me, but I think just now as like as a publisher, like my first thing would be like, wow, how much is this going to cost me? And then the other part would probably be just because it's in that weird spot and just like how many hats you wear, like the time involved. Like I think I would rather like either I'm going to read a short story or I'm going to read a novel, like something in between would just, in just in your own time frame would just be kind of weird. I mean, even if you like them, yeah.
As a reader, I love novels, the longer the better, and for short stories, I really love the flash fiction. I fear with the novellas that you end up with not quite the immersion that you really want from the novel, and you often end up with a lot of exposition, and it gives some writers an excuse to be lazy and to not make it as tight as they need to make it, though there are some really excellent novellas out there.
Speaking as a reader, I really enjoy novelettes and novellas. I don't read a lot of novels. I read mostly short fiction, and a novella is about as long as I really like my stuff to go. And I think short fiction markets are actually missing out because I think it's hard to, really, really hard to read 20,000 words or such on a computer for an extended period of time. I think that if you don't have a tablet and you're reading on an ebook device, a lot of the stuff isn't downloadable. I think that, you know, there's a real space in the market for a short fiction market, probably non-propane because, again, that would be a huge thing in the budget, but just to have a download magazine where you can download it onto your e-reader or your tablet or whatever, you know, or even, you know, print it out. I think that, you know, the main problem with the short fiction on a internet magazine, you know, in addition to the cost, is just like the eye strain and the fact that like reading 20,000 words at a time is very hard sometimes when you can't, you know, save your place or whatnot. So I think that there's a real thing there for the ebooks, for downloads, even free downloads, because it's tested some more work to do, but I think it's really worth it if you care a lot about this middle of the pack fiction in terms of length.
I'm going to ask one more and then see if there's some audience questions, but this one actually came from the BSFS critique group, and they which meets here two Thursdays a month, and they wanted to know, do you ever publish a story you dislike that you know your audience will like, or vice versa, a story that you
think is going to give your audience some trouble, but you love it.
I never publish anything I dislike. but if you go back and read 20, 30, 40 stories out of BCS, there are ones that lean a little bit more toward the adventure side of literary adventure, and there are ones that lean a little more toward the literary side. And I have noticed with different groups of reviewers or different parts of the more vocal readership that there are some groups who really do prefer the more adventure-y ones and others who prefer the more literary ones. I love them all, so I don't care. And I do try to mix them up, or sometimes I'll do an issue that leans a little more one way and then an issue that leans a little more the other. But honestly, my hope is that the people from each of those camps would start or would discover something they like in the stuff that they have not perhaps liked recently, and perhaps see some of what I see in all of them, that they're all interesting characters doing interesting stuff.
I agree. Never anything I don't like. That just goes against everything. I can't even imagine someone thinking we might. But we have published some stories that we weren't sure what was going to happen, like Spar. Spar was one of those stories that we talked a lot about that before we published it, and I think we hid under the desk when it was published. And we told our families, don't read this. It ended up going on and getting award nominations, Year's Best List, things like that. So it was a very pleasant surprise that sometimes those things where you take a gamble, a risk, or you think it's a risk, it turns out to work in your favor.
Just a third, we never publish stories we don't like, but I think we all have a tidbit of a story or whatnot about that story we were uncertain of. I know when I first stepped in as editor of EscapePod, one of the learning experiences I had, I wanted to kind of make a mark off the bat, and I published a story by Mary Robinette Cowell, Servo in Vitro Ujo, I believe is the name. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that exactly right, but it was extraordinarily controversial. It had some pretty graphic rape scenes in it, but it was a very powerful story, and it turned out to be extraordinarily divisive. Out of all of the forums on our threads in our forums, it had something like 15 or 16 different pages of just people that were laying, we had to ban people. It was just a shit show. It was insane. I liked the story a lot, and I hit under the table. I can totally relate to what you're saying there, and I knew there would be some backlash to that, but I thought it was a story that needed to be read. And you know, in retrospect, sometimes I question if I would have run that again, you know, with some experience to my belt. But I think that the people that were very for it had some personal experiences that it was a very meaningful story for them, and there was just as much argument for the other side of it, where this was not something they wanted in their ears, you know. And it was interesting to, it was kind of a litmus test almost to see the audience and the market that we're working with here, to see that how they would respond. I think discussion forums are an important medium now for short fiction markets, the editorial staff to really gauge what their listenership is like, even though it's a very small percentage of what the overall listenership is. It's also one of the most engaged listenerships. They're usually the people that are donating, that are really passionate about it. And when I hear editors and whatnot saying, "Oh, I don't go on the forums or whatever," it's, I see the reasoning behind that and why sometimes I want to do that, because we all have egos and whatnot. But it's important to keep your finger on the pulse of what your audience is doing. I think also one of my favorite things to do as an editor is to commission stories. And the instances where I've been unhappy with a story that we ran were those instances where we would commission a particular author to write something. And unhappy is the wrong word, but you never know what you're going to get. And you're kind of on this weird dance with them where you can only do so much tweaking. You know, you kind of engage them, and you want to have a happy and proactive relationship with them. So the stories that we ran were always well received by the public, but sometimes I'd be like, well, sometimes I was blown away by what authors would get back. But it's a fun experiment when you commission an author to just, and you give them a subject matter, and you basically say, we're going to buy, with a little bit of tweaking here and there, maybe, what do you come back with? It's an adventurous experience, if anything.
I did. There's a story, I admit it, there's a story in Mothership that I absolutely hated. But you know, I had a co-editor, and we had an assistant. I mean, seriously, like, I couldn't finish I think I got to the second paragraph, and I was like, what the hell is this? Threw it out. And then when we were at the end, They both raved over this story. I was like, you gotta be kidding me. And I was like, I had my wife read it. She's like, this is just crap. And I was like, but then I was just like, well, you know, I have to give on occasion. So clearly, I mean, they were just like, this is brilliant. This is great. This is so, and I'm like, okay, I guess maybe, you know, I refuse to believe that I was wrong. Until the reviews started coming, and yeah, people mentioned it. Like this one, as like every time I turn around, people mention it. And as I said, like we record audiobooks for the blind for Library of Congress, and they actually picked Mothership, independent of me. And the narrator was like, man, I love this story. Like every time I turn around, like so I'm like, I finally gave up. But yeah, there's one story in Mothership that I absolutely hated. I did not want to be in, but I was just like, okay, I'll let them have it.
Thank you for validating my question.
Yeah, you know, you do these things.
But your listeners liked it.
Yeah, no, I mean, people who've read it have liked it. Critics have liked, you know, and you're like, But you know, like Juno Diaz, why don't you mention him? No, it's this story right here. You know, it's just like every time you turn around, somebody loves that story. So I was totally wrong.
Some of our favorite stories have been some of the ones that have gotten the lowest ratings in our Rocket Dragon system, where readers can rate it the stories online as they read them. And several times we knew that was coming. And if the story, if you love the story enough, you brace yourself and go ahead and do it.
Erica, do you have any?
All right, so I'm going to open it up to questions. I just want to, I think that you guys might appreciate if I do this for a second, which is, would you raise your hand if you are a reader of short fiction? All right, cool. Would you raise your hand if you're a writer of short fiction? All right, so that shows something cool. Do you have any other questions you want me to ask them? They'll do tricks.
How many of you read any of the things we publish? Good.
I'll ask yours first. How many of you have submitted to one of these magazines? All right. And how many of you have never heard of any of these magazines or anthologies but came because you were interested in the topic? New fans. So after we're done, we're gonna ask some, you guys get to ask some questions too. But there'll be food in the back, and people can definitely come up and chat with them too. For a few minutes.
Those of you all who read online magazines, how many read online on the website? How about e-readers? Interesting.
and then Jonathan wants to know, how about reading by email? All right, anyone else have any other questions? You have this wonderful captive audience.
Podcasts.
Oh, podcasts. How many of you listen to podcasts? Thank you.
What podcast?
Oh, a podcast is audio fiction. Is that a good, quick answer?
Right. Wait, of the podcast people, how many listen while they're commuting to work?
Or doing something that you could not read a book in. Yeah, treadmill.
Oh, this is fun. Oh, so Miriam?
I listen to a playway while I'm swimming.
Oh, all right. How many of you listen while you're exercising? That could be a question, too. All right. Anyone have any other quiz for them before we let them quiz you? All right.
Raise your hand.
Okay, all right, now you can raise your hand and ask the question if you have a question.
So you're talking about comments underneath the stories. How often do you comment back? How involved do you get in the sort of community that's emerging underneath the stories that you publish on the websites? And also, the audio magazine, the podcast, I use audible.com a lot for the stuff I read, and how do you guys just sort of feel about, I know Amazon owns that, is that sort of a, do people have the same attitude about Audible as they do about Amazon, or sort of like this big, fearful monster, or is it, how do you feel about that company?
Can everyone hear the questions? All right, I'll repeat as best as I can. One part of it was whether those of them who have comments on their stories, whether they read the comments and whether they engage about the comments. And then the second part was about audible.com and how people feel about it.
Yeah. Short version. I don't engage much with the commenters because I want them to feel like they have free reign to say whatever they like. Because I'm interested in what they honestly think about the story. So I'm afraid if I'm in there replying to stuff, then the comments will only be people who love the story and not people who didn't.
I'll comment back when there's a question,
right.
But not generally when it's just a comment. They're entitled to their opinion, even if I think it's wrong. As for Amazon, like I said before, I was a bookseller. They were one of the reasons that hurt my business.
Yep.
Now they're my biggest friend. Because if it wasn't for them, I wouldn't be making any money, or enough money to cover all our costs. We make a decent chunk of our money through Amazon subscriptions and back issue sales. We have been approached by Audible to do something with them. I can't talk about it much, but I can say that it's been rocky at best.
I think it's important to listen to feedback on the forums. I myself stopped commenting on story-related commentary just as a thing. You know, I don't want to have a knee-jerk reaction and say something stupid when I've had a couple whiskeys or whatever. You know, it stays on the internet and whatever. It's best personal policy for me. But I do comment on other regards as far as technical things in sections of the forums that have questions. Like Neil said, it's fantastic about future plans, other podcasts, things like that. But as far as stories go, it's better for me to not engage in that. We have enough people throwing their hat in, and I feel like the story should stand on its own, and the fact that we published it is statement enough for me. As far as Amazon, that's for me in podcast fiction, it's still a different ball game a little bit. I love Audible, and I use it for novels and things like that, but I think that one way that it could be a challenge for us, podcasts are generally, it's 9 out of 10 times free. And a lot of people don't know what podcasts are. We just discovered that, and that's still the case with people. And it's hard to give an elevator speech about what a podcast is. But at the same, and also the fact that it's free sometimes hurts. If there's this conception of you get what you pay for, and if it's free, then it's going to be crap or whatever. But and that's not the case with a lot of these really fine quality audio productions going out there. If you're paying, Random House and some of these places, audiobooks are huge, but you're paying out the ass for this stuff a lot of times. And you can a lot of times get some of the same stories by the same authors for free in serialized form on the internet if you know what to look for. But they have a whole system set up where it's easy to find and sort of search. And you know, you go online trying to find podcasts and you're going to find a million of them out there. And that's where the challenge comes in. It's not necessarily what they're doing, because a lot of times it's not short fiction. They'll have anthologies maybe, but it's more long form and things like that, books. And we're not competing with that myself so much. And this is a short fiction table, so it doesn't apply as much. But certainly there are aspects of it that are competitive, or at least frustrating, I think, for us.
Do you read your Amazon comments, Bill? Just curious. Yeah.
Nah. Well, I mean, I do, but
I don't
really care.
You
have
comments back.
Well, no, I mean, I just don't care what people think.
One thing is that if you ever write a short story and it gets a bad review, don't engage with the bad review, because I've only had a few of my stories, reviewed and like the good and bad, but it's best not to just engage with people at all. If somebody emails you and really likes your story, then I've emailed people back, but online it just usually turns out badly for writers and everyone really.
Just to take on that, to also follow on something I said earlier, Mary, the story that we ran in Servo, in Vitro Ubo or whatever, that's generally what I would say too, but she had a whole blog post on her website, which is a fantastic resource, by the way. I can't remember the name of it off the top of my head, Milk, Shades, and Honey or something, I think. Do you guys know the website of Mary Robinette?
I think she has a Mary Robinette.
Yeah.
You guys could find it. She does a lot of writing advice, a lot of things like that, and she had a really... she did engage with somebody who was commenting, who personally wrote her an email based on the story that we ran. I was upset because I really feel like I should have been getting these hate mail, because I'm the person that decided, I solicited her for the story. She wrote it and, it's not really her deal, but she got some hate mail for it, and she responded in a really classy way, I thought, and she had a blog post on how to approach people and when you should or should not respond to criticism and what types of criticism, what's appropriate. And it kind of redefined a lot of the way that I think about communicating with your audience and being empathetic, but also not being a pushover. So I'd encourage you guys to check that out if you can do some Googling on it.
She also has some good resources if any of you are thinking about podcasting. She has good resources for how to read your fiction on her website as well. More questions? I'm gonna go to the woman back there.
For those of us who are either old-fashioned and don't podcast or just prefer to read instead of listen, are any of these podcasts also available in the online? Are they exclusively podcasts or can one read them?
Both of our markets, you can read them online as well. I think the focus is more that we podcast every story we do as opposed to having any of those other stories in other formats as well. But I think it's important to have it in print as well because exactly like you said, not everybody's into listening. That's not the kind of learners that we always are. Everyone's got different ways they want to approach content. And to give your listenership as many options as possible is just the penultimate thing to do.
Yeah. Ultimately, as the publisher, our job is to get the story seen by as many people as possible. So we do it in every meeting we can get away with. We can't do video. You know, that's the one we don't do.
Yeah, we podcast about half the stories, but they're all in text on the website as ebooks. Yeah.
Thank you.
There was a question back there. Eric.
We touched on the zombies, but what's a story that you guys see too much?
What story do you see too much of?
In secondary world fantasy, what I see too much is a story, any story that opens in a fantasy tavern. So think Prancing Pony in Brie, and dozens and dozens of stories that open in that type of building for no reason.
Or in bed, or on the floor looking up at the ceiling, having just woken up. There's a lot of variations on that. The one I'm seeing too many of right now is time travel stories. I don't know why. I asked around, there's been no anthology. Usually that's it. If there was a theme anthology, and I apologize now to all of you, the cyborg stories that you're probably getting. I tend to tell people, shove them in a drawer for a little while, give it time to cool off so that your story actually is different than everything else that's going on at the moment. So, you know, hundreds of cyborg stories are going out, and next year only a half dozen of them are going out, then your odds are better then.
We see a lot of dead body and detectives starting off. It may or may not be on Earth. And we, in the Flash, end up with a lot of kids in the playground that turns out to be God creating Earth. And that gets kind of
old,
We must have seen 50 in the last couple of years.
I'm not against a particular, shoot me, I guess, Neil, but I'm okay with zombies. And, I love
the zombies.
Yeah, they're cool with me. Not every zombie, but you can tell, no matter how tired it is, and you were totally right, playground god children thing happens all the time, you'd be surprised. But there's a way to tell that damn good if you know how to do it. I'm always amazed that sometimes writers are able to tell an original zombie story and really hook me. Post-apocalypse is big, and a lot of people are just so fucking sick of it, but I love post-apocalypse, and I'm sick of some of the same character schemes. I think it's really about characters. Is it the same tired, world-weary kind of thing, or is this a new take on something that's original? I think writers shouldn't be afraid of treading in territory that's been done before, as long as they have a unique kind of take on it, or they have a distinctive voice or characters that are interesting. And then, even then, it might not sell, but as a writer myself, I'm always trying to be conscientious of the fact that, oh gosh, time travel stories are so hard to write and have been written so many times, how can I do anything new? And I'm like, I don't want that to hold up my process. You know, I just want to churn it out, and if it's good, you know, then I'll go back and I'll look at it and edit it if I need to, get some other people to read it through. That's a concern. I don't want to hinder my process as what's been done already, and it has to have this new fresh. Cliff Bear and Sarah Monette have created an amazing space opera that mixes in elements of H.P. Lovecraft and Lewis Carroll. It's amazing, and I've never met one human being who was not just completely begging this would be made into a movie. They have three, I think two of them are short story length, one of them's novella form, one of them's called Mongoose, the other one's The Wreck of the Charles Dexter Ward, and the third one's called Boojum. They're giant fish spaceships that people are in. And we've run them full cast, full audio on the Drabblecast, all three of those. The record of the Charles Dexter Ward, which was in Year's Best, I think, last year, was actually first, it was a commissioned story from the Drabblecast. And it's a great, it's got a little bit of Lovecraft reanimation zombies in there, and some science gone horribly awry, and things like that. But I would definitely encourage people to check out that universe and to harass and harangue both of those women to write more in it, because they really should, because it's a fantastic collaboration. It's amazing to see those two, what they can come up together when they put their heads together.
Their names again, please?
It's Elizabeth Bear and Sarah Manette, and the stories are Mongoose, The Wreck of the Charles Dexter Ward, and Boojum, which I think is B-O-O-J-U-M. They're all three of those at the Drabblecast, but I think they're found in print on our website, but also in other places where they were first published. So, but if you Google them, they'll come up.
Okay. Scott mentioned Yoon's collection, but he didn't name it. So Conservation of Shadows by Yoon Ha Lee is an excellent collection. It's been out for a while, but it's still in print, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. The publisher of the collections in the back there. It has several of the stories are from Clark's World, so if you want to check her out first, you can check out Conservation of Shadows is one of them. You can check them out on our website, and if you like that one, you'll probably like the rest of the collection. One of the other things I'd like to do, though, is recommend a place to get some of this stuff. Waitlist Books, an online independent ebook store that's run by the people who publish Lady Churchill's Rosebud Rislet, which is another short fiction magazine, and Small Beer Press. They've done some great stuff over the years, and you can find a lot of magazines online there, including some foreign ones like Innerzone and others.
I definitely second the Waitlist Books. BCS, we have subscriptions in all our anthologies there, and you can get one account there, and they have all sorts of genre magazines and literary magazines. It's a great place. Definitely Yoon's collection. Another writer I would say definitely look for her stuff is Elliot de Bodard, who's from Paris. And in BCS, I had a bunch of her stuff 4 and 5 years ago, her earlier stuff. She's since had many stories in Clark's World, including one that was a Hugo finalist last year. And I had one from her a couple weeks ago in one of our science fantasy issues. But she's very much a voice to read and pay great attention to. And one of the interesting things to me is to have read the progression of her work going back 5-6 years and seeing the different interesting directions it's taken, not only thematically, but stylistically. So I definitely recommend her work.
I just finished reading on my Kindle the Love Minus 80 by Roy McIntosh, and I highly recommend it. It was based on a short story, but it is a novel. In terms of short stories, I'll go back a ways, and Stories of Your Life and Other Stories is an anthology by Ted Chiang, and really some amazingly well-crafted stories.
Everyone already knows about most of the pro markets. If you don't, you know, there's Lightspeed, Clark's World, obviously, Innerzone, which is a British magazine. So I'm going to say some of the magazines that are smaller, but I think still have an incredible quality of their stories. One of them is Kaleidotrope. I read that whenever it comes out. It's a very good semi-pro magazine that publishes a lot of very interesting work. Another one is Ideomancer. One of my favorite magazines that you know, publishes a lot of experimental stuff, a lot of weird fiction, the third one is Lakeside Circus, which is a new magazine that also publishes mostly flash fiction by a lot of really well-known writers, and all of these can be found online for free, and I think you should check them out.
I want to say thank you to our panelists for coming out here tonight, and thank you all for being here. I think Alexander's going to say something, but go to bisfis.org is probably what you're going to say if you want to know about future events we're doing, and join our Facebook page so you can read about future events also.
For those of you who don't know, our panelists were kind enough to drive from as far away as other parts of the city, from DC, from Northern Virginia, and even from New Jersey, I believe. So let's give them another round of applause. Society has two major events coming up. I know there's a lot of writers here. For those of you who have not been published professionally, who are not eligible CIFLA members, you should enter the BSFS, the Baltimore Science Fiction Society Amateur Writing Contest. If you're 18 and over, if you write, if you do short stories, you enter, there's no cost. It opens April 1st. First place is $250, membership at BaltiCon, you'll be published in our convention guide, and it's just looks cool to win a contest, I think. After that, the next major event, I believe you've heard of a little convention called BaltiCon that we run. You got the flyer. BaltiCon is how we pay the bills. It's supporting us, means coming to BaltiCon, it means meeting the writers and the readers who go there. It means participating in the science fiction community that we help run every Memorial Day weekend up in Hunt Valley. So please, follow us on Facebook, participate in our regular events, come out to BaltiCon, tell your friends you had an awesome night here. Now, I believe Neil will be selling copies of your
anthologies and submission
in the back, and Jonathan will also have copies of Daily Science Fiction Year 1 and 2 that he'll be selling. Scott Andrews will be handing out flyers for Beneath Seas and Skies. Feel free to hang around, the building will be open for a couple more hours. Please socialize, mingle, snack, talk.
Anyway,